Good morning, everyone.
I think finance people are really cool. So thank you so much for giving me the honor to be here this morning. I've been asked to come here to share some of the insights about young people and perhaps why they matter. So a lot of times when I get to speak about millennials, I get one of two reactions, right? The first one is people roll their eyes. They were like, I was young before, what's the big deal? Okay? And the second one, you get over-enthusiastic people who are just like, millennials, yes, everything should be about them. So I'm very intrigued to see the kind of group we have today and what are some of the thoughts that you all here might have about millennials. Just to give context, when I talk about millennials, I am talking about people born between the years of 1980 to early 2000. So it's a very wide range, right? And supposedly these people are all the same. So I will be speaking from my experiences, and of course experiences are different depending on the context where people grew up, but this is just from my experience and what I've learned working with young people. But before I start, I think I would like to show you a video of what some people think of millennials, so please do enjoy.
Ding ticka ding ticka ding 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 doo-doo-a-doo-doo-a-doo-doo-a-doo-doo-a-doo-doo-a-doo. There he sits inside your local coffee shop, sporting a main bun and facial hair. Somehow he believes, although he has no job, that by his 30s he will be a millionaire. M-I-L-L-E-N-N-I-A. On her Instagram with the quote that's inspirational, hopes to change the world while wearing yoga pants, armed with her dreams and knowledge of essential oils. M-I-L-L-E-N-N-I-A. Criticism isn't easy for their ears. They feel like they know most everything. See, they grew up with undeserved confidence, 'cause they got trophies just for participating. M-I-L-L-E-N-N-I-A. L, gotta love millennials.
I think I know who my crowd is today. So let's get into it. Let's get into it. So the world is changing at a rapid change, at a rapid, rapid pace. Climate change, technology, the way in which we are dating is different. People get ghosted. people swipe left and right, the way in which we interact with each other. I know millennials hate phone calls. Anybody with me in the room would rather text, right? So the way in which we're interacting with each other is changing a lot. And at the same time, within your organizations that you are at, you are also being challenged to, sorry, this clicker is kind of working behind my schedule, so to innovate, to evolve, to be agile, to be disruptive, to maintain profit. And I think this is a lot to manage all at once for organizations. But there's one more thing, right? The buzzword of all buzzwords. The thing that makes everybody cringe. The word millennials. So this guy's put an extra dynamic in terms of the things that we are trying to do in our organizations as well. There's a lot of stereotypes that go with millennials. So people will say they are very entitled. People will say that they love instant gratification. Companies will say that they are not loyal. Some people will say that they are very risky. But millennials are also quite smart, right? They are tech savvy. They are globally connected while being locally invested. These young people are also very socially conscious. These young people are also making a difference in their own spaces in their own way. They are also moonlighting while they're working for different organizations as well. So this makes them quite diverse. And I think that this group of people also understands diversity than what we had looked at diversity in the past. They are also your future and current customers. When we talk millennials, people are normally thinking we're speaking about the young people that just graduated and coming into organizations, but some of them are becoming moms. They're young people who are becoming moms and dads. They're becoming parents. They are young people who are leaders. They are leading big organizations. And so they're not necessarily just these young people that have to wait their turn before they can get an opportunity to do something. What I think is important is for us to shift our perspective in terms of how we see these young people, in terms of how we, I'm getting nods and shakes of heads, in terms of how we engage with them. The perspective needs to change for these guys. And I think that video was just a demonstration of how there's so much stereotypes that come with this group of people that needs to change. So Deloitte does a millennial survey. We've been doing it for the last 8 years. The millennial survey is something that everyone can read. It's online, it's free. And they did one in 2018 talking about 50% of millennials reject working for a company. And the reasons why these young people are rejecting working for any company is because they feel that their values are not aligned with the values of the companies. So companies have all these values and what they believe, and when the young people go into those organizations, they see a misalignment. Young people are rejecting to work for organizations because they say that organizations are not looking at them holistically. They just look at them as, you're an engineer and this is what you are here to do. Whereas these young people, some of them are engineers, but then in the evening, they're DJs. On Sundays, they're community leaders. So they want to go into organizations where they are being looked at holistically. They are rejecting to work for companies because they are feeling that companies are not focused on their purpose. Companies put up these big signs to say that they're impactful, but when the young people go in and they say, where is the impact here? What do they actually mean? So this was an interesting insight in terms of what these young people were thinking in 2018. There is actually the 2019 survey has come out, so you can go onto Google and just look it up and you'd be able to see what the young people are thinking now. And in terms of who was asked these questions, it was young people, young professionals globally, including in South Africa and the rest of Africa. Another question that was asked to these young people was around stability and loyalty within the working environment. And in South Africa, they were asked how many of these young people will stay with their current employers. And a whopping 43% said that they think they will stay with their current employer for up to 2 years. And an interesting stat that is aligned to that is that these young people are also feeling that when they go into their job, they've got one foot out the door. So as soon as they go into their job, they're thinking about what's next. And I think employees have a difficult time interacting with this because they're spending so much money trying to find the right fit, trying to find the right people, training them, and then the next thing, they're out. What I think needs to be done is that we just need to find a way to work with that energy of them leaving, and perhaps they'll come back because they boomerang. That's probably what millennials do anyways, right? So perhaps we need to find ways to say, okay, we have you here, you can go, let's find a way for you to come back because this is how they're feeling. We also looked at how many of these young people would prefer full-time employment. And in South Africa, 56% of young people said that they preferred full-time employment versus freelance. And 43% of millennials in South Africa said that they prefer freelance versus freelance consultative employment. So it kind of shows these young people are not feeling like being in one organization for a very long time. When they hear people have been in organization for 10 years, they freak out. Our parents are very proud at the fact that I was in one company for a lot of years, whereas this is not something that these millennials are proud about. So it's kind of that we need to change our mindset and think differently about how we engage them while they are in the organizations that we are in. So there is a big misunderstanding and disconnect between the two or the three or the four different generations. And I think it's mainly because the millennials were born into a generation where things are faster, where the world is where the world is. And so a person who was born in the 50s and who's saying, I was young, I used to work in corporate, is very different for someone in today's world in corporate in a different setup. So we need to find ways to engage both people and find a way for people to engage together and find a way to connect. The way that businesses are built and the systems of businesses are very outdated for these young people. The hierarchy of the structure, the systems, it makes it very hard for young people to have a seat at the table and have a voice. These young people live in a place where they are seeing successful people through their social media, through YouTube, and then they go to organizations where they are being told, wait your turn, you have to be here for 10 years before we promote you, or you have to be here for a certain amount of time before you can tell us what needs to change in the organization. So these organizations that were born or were built, which they are good for everything else, but in terms of being able to engage this generation of young people, it's very hard. So I think organizations should think really differently about telling young people to wait their turn. So I know a lot of organizations have good intentions and they have these bodies where they're calling young people tomorrow's leaders. That for young people means wait your turn. You can only be a leader tomorrow, actually. We are not listening to you today. We'll only wait for your turn tomorrow. And it's very discouraging for these young people to try and engage with the organization. So we should try and find a way to not tell them to wait their turn because they live in a world where they can say whatever they want in 140 characters. They can say what they want in a picture. And so we just need to try and figure out how do we bring these two worlds together. The slower growth opportunities, what's interesting in the work that we've been doing while working with young people is that young people are not always looking to be the next CEO. They're not all gunning for the top job. they are trying to find ways of how they can engage from their strengths from wherever they are. So if there's a young person who's a yoga instructor, they would like to bring that in the organization somehow. If there's a young person who's a photographer, they would like to bring that in the organization the way that they are. So the way that corporate is built today, is just it slows their progress and their progress. We need to change our mindset in terms of how we see their progress being only about being the next CEO. Obviously, companies' objectives can't wait long, so we need to find a way to engage with these young people where they can help us with the company's objectives. Because when we think about innovation, it's not always about starting something new, but it's sometimes about stopping doing something the old way. One of the things that we have learned is that it is very important to find ways to understand different perspectives, right? To find ways to engage with the different perspectives, hear the insights, irrespective of the fact that people have been in an organization for longer and some people are new. It's very important to hear new perspectives because that will give us insight into their world, that will give us insight into how today's generation is operating. Because these young people are choosing who they want to work on, to work with, sorry, based on their values. And if the companies are not aligned with their own values, they leave, or they come there and they do something totally different than they are supposed to be doing within the organization. They've researched companies way before they've come in, so they know a lot. And I'm generally speaking, but they know a lot about the companies before they come in. So it's no longer about companies attracting young, it's no longer about companies just, or young people being attractive to get a job, but it's also now about companies trying to make themselves really attractive for these young people to choose for them. So, but all is not lost, because I'm gonna tell a bit of a story. So I started a company called Springage, and this was about 7 years ago now. And when I started this company, my parents literally thought I was joking. They were like, what are you doing? Go get a proper job. This is a joke. until our company, actually, my parents said this until the day our company was bought by Deloitte. So it then got acquired, and this was a business that I had started with a very good friend of mine, and Deloitte acquired the company. And we started the company because we realized that we live in a continent, in a very young continent. We've got a majority, our population's majority is young people. We've got a very young continent. And we were asking ourselves, how can the voice of young people be heard? Not just in corporate space, but in South Africa, and for young people to be able to make a difference. Because young people have energy, right? So that energy can be utilized in any ways. You can take the energy of young people and get them to go and toy outside a mine because they've got the energy, or you can use that energy for young people to come up with new ideas and insights and to think about their future. So we started a company that said, we would like to incorporate the voice of young people and get them to come up with new ideas and insights for making our country better. We did that a little bit, and it then evolved to saying, we can help big organizations to be able to engage with young people as well, to get different insights for different challenges that they may have. And we did this in three ways, which I will go through quickly. So we help companies understand the millennials, we help companies engage with the millennials, and to be able to innovate. And I think these are also examples of, if you want to engage with young people or get them involved in your organization, maybe these are the three ways to work with them. So the first one is the understand piece. So we know that it's not only about millennials. So sometimes when we go into organizations, they're like, why is it only about them? An organization doesn't only work with young people. So that is true. So we have workshops where it's an intergenerational conversation, where people get to understand each other from different generations. So an example is we've had this company that we worked with, and we had this session where we had, we divided people in terms of baby boomers, in terms of Generation X, in terms of millennials, and then we said, what are the pros and cons do people see within the different generations? The people would then say, the millennials will say, well, the pros about us is that we're tech savvy, we're this and this and this, and would ask the different generation, and the different generation would say, well, you know, the cons about these guys is that they're risky, they're not loyal, and so forth. Then would ask the millennials, what are the pros and cons of the other generation? And they would say things like, oh, the baby boomers are like CIAs, you never get information from them, they just keep everything to themselves. They would say things like, you know, these guys are like, they always hoard the information, they want to see you at your desk, even if you're not working, they'd rather see you rather than not go. So we had that conversation. And then both the baby boomers and the millennials, which make good teams, by the way, would all talk about the Gen X, saying, oh, those guys will tell you about the MBAs that they have and how they went to Oxford and Stanford and all of that stuff. So, and then we'd have this intergenerational conversation where we're saying, okay, so, but what does it then mean? How did we get here? And I remember one particular case where the one gentleman who was a baby boomer was saying, you know, where I'm coming from is that we used to have to keep all the knowledge to ourselves. That showed how much knowledge you had by learning all the things that you're learning. So I can't just give you everything. You have to work for it. You have to deserve it. You have to, you know, all of those steps. But then you're getting the different generations to start understanding each other and where each other are coming from. And that's what helps the conversations going. So that could be a way to kind of start engaging different people and understanding the different people in the workspace. The second one is around engagement. So we came up with a concept called the Millennial Board. And the Millennial Board has been phenomenal. It's been fun. Because this is where you get young people to engage on a specific topic in an organization that is asked by an exco member, so CEO or CFO or whatever the case is. And you get these young people to then try and come up with new ideas for that specific challenge that has been set for them. And what has been really great about how the Millennial Board is constructed is that firstly, you are asking for young people from within that organization, and these young people come from across different business units. So as we know in corporates, it's not always easy to get people working from across different business units, but the Millennial Board is constructed that you get people from across. And then you don't only get people because of the fact that you're an engineer, you're a CA, you ask them about the challenge, and then based on the answer for the challenge, people get chosen to participate in the Millennial Board. And millennials love that. They love a competition. They love to send us videos of why should you be chosen. They love talking about themselves, so you indulge that, right? And so so we asked those questions, and it was this the most phenomenal thing where you're getting a young office clerk who's like, actually, I'm this community leader at home, and this is what I've done. This is the impact I've done in my community. And this is kind of like a new thing that the organization was not aware of. But because of the kind of questions we've asked people, they were able to tell us a little bit about who they are. And we've set these up for lots of other businesses as well. And it's just been a good way for young people, firstly, to understand what goes on at the top level. So not only can they say, oh, we should do this, they now understand the constraints, right, of why certain things can't happen. They now understand how much it takes to get people from different business units to start working together. They now understand how much it takes to get people going on a specific project. So we've used this as an engagement tool, and not necessarily kind of development tool, but rather a thing where you're saying, you've got something to offer, we would like to hear what that thing is that you have to offer. So you're extracting information from the young people. So that's been really great. And the last one is kind of the innovating with young people. So the the way in which we've innovated with them, we've come up with a concept called youth-led innovation, and we have a process called a spring break, and work with these young people, which we call springers, and we get a challenge from an organization and get young people from diverse backgrounds to come and help answer that question. So statistically speaking, there are smarter people out there than there can be any in any organization. So we utilize the fact that we can use the diversity of young people externally to help with the challenge. So how that works is that we would have a specific challenge given to us. We would then, based on the challenge, go and recruit a number of about 12 inspirational young people. So they can be MBA students, they can be community leaders, they can be soccer players, they can be artists, they can be students, they can be young professionals, lawyers, and this kind of thing. And you put them on all in one room and you throw the challenge to them and you find a way to come up with new ideas for a specific challenge that an organization has. And the reason why we've chosen young people is just they don't know what they don't know. So they will come up with things that are not constrained. They won't say, oh, we can't do this because we tried it 10 years ago and it didn't work. Or they won't say that, oh, this was tried in another department and it didn't work. They will just think out of the box and they will come up with their bold ideas based on their world, based on their understanding. And we found that it's something that works very well. So that's me. I think my parting words would be that I encourage everyone to kind of engage with the idea of youth-led innovation. Because of the context in which we live in. We've seen how other companies have used the spirit of young people to be able to get remarkable results. I think it's not something that we should be scared of. I think we are in South Africa, so our context is different, but young people do have a spirit that we can utilize, that we can use, that can be able to be fruitful for your different organizations. So I think I've got Q&A cage, so I will wait for that. Thank you.